My name is Christina Alimo, and I'm a student here at the University of Toronto. On behalf of the Newman Center, in conjunction with the group Power to Change, I'd like to thank you all for coming to this morning's talk. Dr. Michael Behe holds his PhD in biochemistry and has authored the best-selling book titled Darwin's Black Box, The Biochemical Challenge to Evolution. He is an intelligent design advocate and is best known for his argument for irreducible complexity. Dr. Behe has been published by numerous peer-reviewed journals and has also written editorial features in the Boston Review, the American Spectator, and even the New York Times. He currently serves as professor of biochemistry at Lehigh University in Pennsylvania and as a senior fellow of the Discovery Institute's Center for Science and Culture. This morning, we will start with Dr. Behe's lecture entitled Evidence of Design from Biology.
Well, thank you very much. I'm going to give a relatively brief talk so that there is plenty of time for questions. Title of the talk is Evidence for Design from Biology. And since the idea of intelligent design is very controversial, in case you haven't noticed, I always begin my talks with a disclaimer that says that I'm speaking for myself, that don't blame my colleagues for it, don't take it out on students from Lehigh or anything like that. This is all my responsibility. And the argument that I'm going to present today is one that was actually published as an op-ed piece in the New York Times in the year 2005, so seven-ish years ago now. And it was a time of controversy in the United States. There was an impending trial in Pennsylvania about whether intelligent design was could be taught in the public schools. And the editors of the New York Times asked me to write an op-ed piece kind of explaining in a brief and easy to follow way what the heck is intelligent design and what's the argument for it. So the point here is that if you can summarize your argument in an op-ed piece, then it's not hard to follow. And my argument is going to consist of 5 points. And the first one is this, that design is not some mystical conclusion. You don't have to close your eyes and raise up your hands to be able to come to a conclusion of design. It's deduced from the physical structure of a system. The second point is going to be that everyone agrees that aspects of biology appear to be designed. And when I say everyone, I mean even those folks who are most strongly opposed to the notion that appearance reflects reality. And those who disagree with it or who think that the appearance of design is misleading generally think that there is another non-design explanation for that appearance. And the leading contender is Darwin's theory of evolution. And so my third point is to tell you why I think that there are structural obstacles to Darwinian evolution. That is, there are physical reasons to think that it cannot do what its proponents ascribe to it. But you say, you know, every time you read a science magazine or watch a science program on TV that touches on the topic, you know, we are assured that science already knows that Darwinian processes can explain life as we observe it. And so my fourth point will be to argue that those grand Darwinian claims rest on undisciplined imagination rather than hard data. And my fifth point then will be kind of a summary point. It'll be that this right now, in the year 2012, we have in hand strong evidence for design in biology, but little evidence that Darwinian processes can explain much of it. So we're going to start out with the first point. Design is not mystical. It's deduced from the physical structure of a system. But before that, we have to ask the question, well, what is intelligent design? What do we mean by intelligent design? And if you look in a dictionary, you'll see a bunch of definitions. But the, wow, I think I might get a, you know, a stroke or something as lights go on and off. If you look in a dictionary, you'll see a bunch of definitions, but the pertinent one is something like this, that design is the purposeful or inventive arrangement of parts or details. And you can simplify that and just say that design is the purposeful arrangement of parts. And that means that we infer design, or we conclude that design has happened whenever parts appear to have been arranged to accomplish a function. Well, okay, that's a bunch of words, and it's oftentimes easier to grasp a concept if you see an example. So let's take a look at an example on the next slide here, if you can see that. This is a Far Side cartoon. Got Far Side in Canada too? Yeah, okay, great. I love this guy, crazy. So we've got here in the cartoon a troop of jungle explorers, and up here the lead explorer has been strung up and skewered, and this guy here turns to this guy here and says, "That's why I never walk in front." Words to live by, let me assure you. Okay, now everybody in this auditorium looks at this cartoon here, and you immediately realize, going the wrong way. You immediately realize that this was designed. This was not an accident. How do you know that? How do you know that was designed? Is it a religious conclusion? Oh, probably not, unless you have a strange religion. No, you know this is designed because you see a number of parts arranged for a purpose, of the purposeful arrangement of parts. So again, we deduce design from, from the purposeful arrangement of parts. And I should add that the humor of the cartoon depends upon you recognizing the design of this trap. It wouldn't be very funny if you just fell over a cliff or something like that. So we humans are good at recognizing design, even design with just natural components, as in this jungle trap. Okay, there's one more aspect of design that we have to make sure we touch on, or we may get confused, and that is the strength of the inference to design is quantitative. And that means that the more and more and more parts you have, and the more and more and more suited to the function they are, the more and more and more and more certain you can be that they were designed. And again, that's a definition. So let's look at an example. Suppose you had a friend who invited you down to the United States, and you'd like to go out hiking. And so you and your friend were walking by these mountains, the Sawtooth Mountains in Idaho. And your friend turned to you and said, "Where do you think these mountains came from?" And you said, "Gee, I never did have that geology class. Plate tectonics, volcanic activity, something like that." And most people would be happy with that explanation. And suppose your friend said, "Yeah, but you see this tallest peak here? If you draw a line from that to the second highest peak, then it makes an angle of 15 degrees with the vertical." And you would respond, so what? You know, it's got to look like something, you know, 15 degrees, 16, so what, you know? And, you know, most people would think that would be a reasonable answer. But now suppose you and your friend, you're very vigorous, and so you continued walking until you got to New Hampshire. And you walked by this mountain, and this is called the Old Man of the Mountain. And you see the people up there, these are actually construction workers trying to stabilize the structure because it was getting to be unsteady. Unfortunately, it actually fell down a few years ago, but it is no longer there. But suppose your friend asked you the same question. How do you think that got there? And you'd say, well, gee whiz, look, that top part up there looks like a chin. And the other part looks like a nose. And the other part looks like a forehead up here. And you know, there's looks like a mouth here too. Do you think that some prehistoric tribe might have, you know, nah. You say, nah, this is just a lucky arrangement of the rocks, you know. If you look at it from the other side, it doesn't look like much of anything. It's kind of coincidence. And most people would be happy with that. But you and your friends still have a bunch of energy, and so you continue to South Dakota, and you go by these mountains. And now the friend asks the same question. Where do you think these came from? And now you would never think to say tectonic activity or volcanic activity. It is clear just from the first glance, even if you had never heard of Mount Rushmore before, even if you did not know the people whose images these are, that these parts of the mountain containing the faces were purposely designed. And how can you tell that? You can tell it because the parts of the mountain are arranged for a purpose, to portray the images of those presidents. And now suppose your friend asks you, if I can see where I am, that why do you think that this rock is kind of at an angle of 20 degrees with respect to the vertical? And if I pointed correctly, the reason would be to portray the nose of George Washington. So now questions like why is it that way have answers. Okay? So the point again is that design is not mystical. It's deduced from the physical structure of a system. Okay, now the second point is that everyone agrees that aspects of biology appear to be designed. And when I say everyone, I mean everyone. And as an example of every man, I will take Richard Dawkins, who is the perhaps foremost defender of Darwinian theory alive today. And about 25 years or so ago, he wrote his best-selling book, The Blind Watchmaker, which is a full-throated defense of Darwin's theory. Nonetheless, on the very first page of the very first chapter, Dawkins wrote the following. He wrote, "Biology is the study of complicated things that give the appearance of having been designed for a purpose." That is the very definition of biology, according to Richard Dawkins, the study of things that give the appearance of having been designed for a purpose. Okay, now he doesn't actually think they were designed for a purpose. He just thinks they give the appearance of having been designed. But why does he think that? I mean, he doesn't think they were designed, but why does he think that they even look like they were designed? Is it because of the aesthetic appeal because, you know, puppies are so cute and, you know, sunsets are so beautiful, flowers are so beautiful. No, not according to Richard Dawkins. According to Dawkins, it isn't for aesthetic reasons that they appear to be designed. It's for engineering reasons. He goes on to say, 20 pages later, that we may say that a living body or organ is well designed if it has attributes that an intelligent and knowledgeable engineer might have built into it in order to achieve some sensible purpose, such as flying, swimming, seeing. Any engineer can recognize an object that has been designed, even poorly designed, for a purpose, and he can usually work out what that purpose is just by looking at the structure of the object. So what is he saying here? He's saying we recognize design in the purposeful arrangement of parts. So essentially, he's agreeing that that's how one comes to a conclusion of design, or at least for him, the appearance of design. Well, okay, thing, as we said, the appearance of the design is quantitative. It can be more, it can be less. So what are we talking here? Are we talking like, you know, faces in clouds? Are we talking like the old man of the mountain, or what? Well, no, according to Richard Dawkins, we're talking way beyond Mount Rushmore. He says that the appearance of design is overpowering. He writes, of course, he thinks that Darwinian evolution is correct. So he writes, natural selection is the blind watchmaker. Blind because it does not see ahead, does not plan consequences, has no purpose. Yet, the living results of natural selection overwhelmingly impress us with the appearance of design, as if by a master watchmaker, impress us with the illusion of design and planning. Okay, so we're not talking old man of the mountain here. We're talking, you know, Mount Rushmore to the nth power. So that was the point that everyone, even people as strongly opposed to the reality of design as Richard Dawkins, everyone agrees that aspects of biology appear to be designed. Well, okay, Dawkins and most biologists don't think that design is real. Many think that Darwinian evolution is responsible for the appearance of design. So my next point will be to argue that there are structural obstacles to Darwinian evolution. There are reasons, physical reasons, to think that it cannot do what it claims to be able to do, or what its supporters claim to be it can do. And I developed this argument in my first book, Darwin's Black Box, which was published some 16 years ago or so now. Time flies. I had brown hair back then. The problem, problems for Darwinism are many, but one was noted kind of prominently by Charles Darwin himself, in a section in which he discussed what he called organs of extreme perfection, including the vertebrate eye. And at the conclusion of that section, Darwin wrote, if it could be demonstrated that any complex organ existed which could not possibly have been formed by numerous successive slight modifications, my theory would absolutely break down, adding, but I can find out no such case. In this passage, Darwin was insisting that evolution, as he envisioned it with his mechanism, had to work slowly, in tiny steps, over long periods of time, because he knew that if things improved rapidly, in large leaps, it would look suspiciously as if something other than random variation and selection were involved. So Darwin always insisted on this gradual progression of evolution. Well, let's take Darwin's word for it and ask ourselves, what sort of complex organ or system sure doesn't look like it could be formed by numerous successive slight modifications? And such a system is one which I have called irreducibly complex, or that has the property of irreducible complexity. Now, irreducible complexity is a fancy phrase. I kind of made it up to make people think that I was smart. Hasn't worked yet. But it stands for a simple concept. It just means that you've got a system that has a number of components to it which interact with each other to produce a function that the components cannot do by themselves. And if you take one or more of the components away, the system doesn't work. So it's irreducible. And again, that's a bunch of words. But a good example of irreducible complexity from our everyday world is shown on the next slide. And this is just a simple mechanical mousetrap, a kind you can buy in a hardware store or various places. And as you can see, it's got a number of parts here. It's got the wooden base to which everything is attached. It's got this tightly wound spring to which an extended end is here to press against the platform, and another extended end is here to lap over this other metal part, which is called the hammer, and which is actually the part that squashes the mouse. And you've got to push the hammer over, and it's got to be stabilized in place until the mouse comes along. And that's the job of something called the holding bar, which goes over the hammer, and then the tip of the holding bar itself has to be stabilized in place. And that's the job of something called the catch. Now, the trap needs all these parts to work. If you take away one of the pieces of the trap, say you take away the spring or the holding bar or the hammer, you do not have a mouse trap that works half as well as it used to, or a quarter as well as it used to. You have a broken mouse trap. So this is what I mean by irreducibly complex. It turns out things like this are big headaches for Darwin's theory. Because if you wanted to evolve something like a mousetrap by something like a Darwinian process, you know, how would you do that? Where would you start? Would you start maybe with the big wooden platform and hope to catch mice inefficiently? You know, maybe you could trip them as they ran over the platform. And then maybe you could add another part, maybe the holding bar here. And then maybe if they tripped, they'd impale themselves on the holding bar. That it would increase the efficiency. No, that's silly. Because irreducibly complex systems only work when they're pretty much completely intact. So this would be a very big challenge to Darwin's theory if such a thing existed in biology. So the question is, do such systems exist in life, in biology? Are there irreducibly complex systems, especially at the foundation of life, at the cellular and molecular level, which we have discovered, modern science has discovered to be the basic level of life? And the answer is yes, they're all over the place. And my favorite example of one, because it makes such a good visual impression, is something called the bacterial flagellum, which is quite literally an outboard motor which bacteria use to swim. And as you can see, it's got a number of parts. It's got this long filamentous thing here, which acts as the propeller, which it turns round and around and around and pushes against water and pushes the bacterium forward. It's attached to the drive shaft by something called the hook, which acts as a universal joint, which transmits the rotary motion of the drive shaft in this plane to the rotary motion of the propeller in another plane. The drive shaft is attached to the motor, which uses a flow of acid from the outside of the cell to the inside to power the turning, just like water flowing over a dam can power the turning of a turbine. This whole schmear has to be kept in place while it's turning, just like an outboard motor on a boat has to be clamped onto the boat while it's working. And some proteins act as a stator material to keep it in place. And there's other parts too. There's several proteins which act as bushing material to allow the drive shaft to poke up through the bacterial membrane without leaking and so on. So I hope that you can see that, like a mousetrap, the bacterial flagellum is irreducibly complex. If it weren't for the propeller, or if it weren't for the drive shaft, or if it weren't for the motor, or many of the other parts, the flagellum would not spin half as fast as it used to, or a quarter as fast as it used to. It would be a broken flagellum, would not spin at all. Or, more likely, it would not be made by the cell. Because in addition to this, the cell has sensitive feedback mechanisms that tell it when the construction of this apparatus is going well or not. And if it senses that it's not going well, it shuts down production so as not to waste energy on a broken apparatus. Now, I like to show audiences this drawing of the flagellum, which is from a popular biochemistry textbook by Vogt and Vogt, because most people, when they see it, quickly apprehend that this is a machine. It's not like a machine. It's not analogous to a machine. This is a real molecular machine. And perhaps our experience with where machines come from can help us understand where such a thing as this might have come from. Well, okay, the bacterial flagellum, it's pretty fancy, all right. Is this the only molecular machine in the cell? Well, no. It turns out that the cell is chock full of complex molecular machinery. The kind of crowning achievement of modern biology is to show that, in fact, the cell is this sophisticated, essentially nanoscale factory. A journal issue which makes this point is this issue of Cell, which I can barely see, from about 10 or so years ago. And it's a special issue on molecular machines. So molecular machine is not something, a phrase that I thought up. It's in common use in biology. And if you turn the page and you look at the table of contents, you'll see articles with titles such as "The Cell is a Collection of Protein Machines," "Polymerases in the Replisome, Machines Within Machines," "Mechanical Devices of the Spliceosome," "Motors, Clocks, Springs, and Things." So the point is that such machines fill the cell. And a point to consider is, if it is so difficult to think of how even such a simple thing as a mousetrap could be put together by the gradual Darwinian process, think how much more difficult it would be for these sophisticated machines. Okay, so that was the point, that there are structural obstacles to Darwinian evolution. Now, but we are told through essentially the popular media and so on, that in fact science has already shown that Darwinian processes can account for these machines. And I want to tell you that that is an urban legend, that these grand Darwinian claims rest on undisciplined imagination. And I should add that I'm talking about grand Darwinian claims, not simple or smaller Darwinian claims, because as I spoke about last night, Darwinian processes can do some things and very sometimes very medically important things that affect the health of a lot of people. But these grand Darwinian claims that it can produce molecular machines rest on imagination. And just as my support for this, I'm going to rely on a man named Franklin Harold, who's an emeritus professor of microbiology at Colorado State University. And a little over 10 years ago, he wrote a book called The Way of the Cell, which was published by Oxford University Press, which is a very prestigious academic publishing house. And in the course of his book, he turned to the subject of intelligent design briefly. And he had this to say about it. He said, "We should reject, as a matter of principle, the substitution of intelligent design for the dialogue of chance and necessity." And he cited my book. "But we must concede that there are presently no detailed Darwinian accounts of the evolution of any biochemical systems, only a variety of wishful speculations." Well now, that's interesting. I think this is important, so let's linger with Professor Harold here for a minute. In this, he makes two points, and I'm going to take those two points in reverse order. So he says, secondly, that there aren't detailed Darwinian accounts of evolution of biochemical systems, only wishful speculations, or more colloquially known as just-so stories. You know, like the children's stories that were written by Rudyard Kipling over 100 years ago. You know the ones, how the tiger got its stripes, how the rhinoceros got its horn, how the bacterium got its flagellum. You know, it's funny when you think of it in that way, but if you think about it a little longer, it's really astonishing that a theory that has been so fruitless in accounting for the foundation of life is nonetheless accepted by such a large fraction of the scientific community. And it makes you think that perhaps a different theory might be called for. And the first point that Professor Harold makes is that he said we should reject intelligent design as a matter of principle. As a matter of principle. What principle? What principle is that? I mean, I showed you that picture of the flagellum a few slides back, and design is something that kind of leaps off the page at you. It's not something that's hard to see. But apparently, according to Professor Harold and many other folks, we are forbidden to entertain the idea of design because of some principle. But it turns out he never says what the principle is. He just writes what I had up on the slide a couple ago, and then goes on to other topics in his book. Nonetheless, I think I know what principle that Professor Harold has in mind. And it's illustrated here. And that is this, that intelligent design seems to point strongly beyond nature. It seems to have philosophical, maybe even theological implications. And that makes a lot of people uncomfortable. And they think that science should stay well away from theories that have such strong extra-scientific implications. Well, I understand what they are thinking, but I disagree with them. When I was being taught in graduate school and later, we were always told that science is supposed to follow the evidence wherever it leads. Let other people worry about philosophical or other implications. That's not our job. And I thought that was good advice then, and I continue to think that's good advice. So that was the point that grand Darwinian claims rest on undisciplined imagination. And the final point is kind of a summary point, that right now we have in hand strong evidence for design, but little evidence for Darwinism. And you might say to yourself, well, we just saw the little evidence for Darwinism stuff. We saw Franklin Harold's admissions and so on. But remind me again, what is the strong evidence for design that we have? And the evidence is exactly what Richard Dawkins says, that life overwhelmingly impresses us with the appearance of design, as if by a master watchmaker. That is how we recognize design. That is the evidence for design, the purposeful arrangement of parts. And surprisingly, it was not expected, but science has discovered this overwhelming purposeful arrangement of parts at the foundation of life. That is the evidence for design. And this is actually, well, we can ask, what kind of an argument is that? That when we see a purposeful arrangement of parts, we always discover it's been designed. Now we see a purposeful arrangement of parts in the cell, and we're justified in thinking that was designed too. Well, it's actually a kind of an argument that colloquially can be illustrated with the next slide. And what, pray tell, is that? That, of course, is a duck. And how do you know? Because if it looks like a duck, and if it walks like a duck, and if it quacks like a duck, then we are intellectually justified in concluding that that is a duck. And if anybody wants to tell us it's a robot, or if it's something else, the burden of proof will be strongly on them to justify that the evidence of our own eyes is incorrect. Okay, this is the colloquial version, but this is actually a kind of reasoning, one of two kinds of reasoning that philosophers recognize as the major kinds of reasoning. And they call it an inductive argument. And I'm sorry, usually I get tomatoes at this point, but so an inductive argument. Okay, an inductive argument, philosophers, you know, are we talking philosophy or science or what? Well, actually, if you go to a reference book and you look up something like inductive reasoning, you get an explanation such as the following. When a person uses a number of established facts to draw a general conclusion, he uses inductive reasoning. This is the kind of logic normally used in the sciences. So the argument for intelligent design is a scientific argument. It is not a theological, it is not a philosophical argument. It's a scientific argument because it starts from empirical facts. The structures of the machinery that have been discovered in the cell, and it uses the normal mode of reasoning that science uses. So it is a scientific argument. And so I want to conclude this talk just by saying that a conclusion of intelligent design is rationally justified. It's nothing mystical. It's simply us using our brains in their ordinary way. So that is, as I see it, the argument for intelligent design. And thanks very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. B. So right now, we will be transitioning into a question and answer period. And I'm going to leave it to my friend Peter to moderate. So if we're in a fairly small room, so if you could stand up and ask your question in a fairly audible voice.
Thank you. There's a first question. Friends Collins wrote a book, The Language of God, and he thinks that intelligent design is sort of a dog in the gaps type theory. How would you respond to that?
Okay. That's an excellent question. The question was, Francis Collins, a very prominent scientist and a Christian, thinks that intelligent design is a God of the gaps argument. And by that is meant that if we don't understand something in nature, maybe like some people in the past have done, we say, well, God must have done this. What's lightning, said the Norsemen. I don't know, maybe Thor is throwing lightning bolts or something. Well, I would respectfully disagree with the director of the National Institutes of Health. I think that it is not a God of the gaps argument, or another name that people use is an argument from ignorance. We don't know what happened, and so therefore we conclude that God must have done it. The argument for design is an argument from knowledge, not from ignorance. It was a lot easier in Darwin's day, when the cell was thought to be a kind of nondescript piece of jelly, to imagine that natural processes might just bubble up this material from the ocean. And then, heck, if you kind of pushed on one side and pulled on the other, maybe it'd be shaped into some form. And maybe then his random changes and natural selection could kick in. The argument for design has gained strength the more that science has discovered. When science started to discover what's in the cell, DNA, that DNA is a genetic code, that there are molecular machines which are responsible for translating and transcribing the information in DNA into molecular machinery, that's when the idea of, whoa, you know, this is are very similar to processes that we know are designed in our everyday world. And we know that they need design because we know how improbable it is to make machinery, even a simple mousetrap you've got to purposely put together. So this is not an argument of the type that, physicists a few years ago saw that there were only half as many neutrinos coming from the sun as they expected from their theory. Nobody said, well, God must have just made it that way because the theory doesn't match what's happening. That would be an argument from ignorance. That would be a God of the gaps. This is an argument from knowledge. We didn't know what the cell consisted of. Now we do, and we see that it's this elegant technology that in all of our experience requires design to effect. So I would disagree with him.
Okay. Do you foresee the next development in intelligent design studies is identifying the designer? Science is study of the natural world made out of matter and interacting by forces on matter, so that do you foresee that the ID community now will identify a material designer? And thinking again theologically, do you see a parallel? The problem of getting the bacteria to go needed the design of the flagellum. The problem of our sin needed intervention from God, and God became matter in the form of Christ. Do you see a need then to identify the designer with matter?
That's a very good question. And the first thing I should say is that my degree is in biochemistry. It's not in theology. And so I'm going to take a pass on the second part of your question. And being one of the few sinless people in the world, I don't really give much thought to it anyway. Now, the first one is, will the ID community now turn its attention to identifying the designer? And I would say, I hope not, because I think there are other questions which will be easier and more fruitful to answer than that, even though everybody, I'm sure, would love to know through scientific means who is likely to be that designer. And let me give you an analogy to show you why I think that's a reasonable course of action. In the 1920s and 30s, the Big Bang Theory was first proposed in physics. And up until then, most physicists thought the universe was pretty much eternal and unchanging. But then it was discovered that things seemed to be flying apart, as if in the aftermath of a big explosion. And it didn't take much imagination to think that, well, if you reverse that process, the universe must have started out as a small piece of matter and exploded. Many people, including many physicists, thought that that might have been a supernatural act, maybe a creation event. Maybe that is kind of what was described in Genesis, let there be light or something. Nonetheless, they did not, even though the ones who accepted the Big Bang and started to work on it, did not, as a first matter, try to identify what caused the Big Bang. As a matter of fact, even today, we do not have any settled answer on what physicists think caused the Big Bang. Nonetheless, they were able to work out a lot of implications, essentially saying, given that, you know, the universe started in a Big Bang as a concentrated mass and energy, what would happen as it expanded, what sorts of things, you know, would be produced, and so on. And I think design would be well advised to follow that course, to kind of work out the implications of, if life is designed, what follows from that, rather than to try to identify who the designer is. Well, it could, and that's been proposed by many Darwinists, kind of as, the possibility of last resort. But there's practical problems with that, and that is if you actually try to design something that has a different function and then kind of morphs into something with a other function, you find that the design specs for the first one not necessarily agreeing with the design specs for the second one. And so you have a problem. The thing is that the natural selection, good old natural selection, will tend to hone that system into being as good for that purpose, that original purpose, as possible, which means it's not thinking about a new purpose. And therefore, it's somewhat unlikely. And people who have tried to kind of make arguments that that's possible that I have read have not, I have not thought they were very persuasive. And you can't get anybody more objective than myself on that. Turning one thing into another, especially if it's a complicated thing in the first place, is harder than it sounds. One more?
So wouldn't we live in a world where all scientists conform to an intelligent design worldview? Suppose like in scientific journals, they conclude, therefore we scientifically conclude that this intelligent designer has an interesting mind and is quite complex, or we start to cite God for inspiration or ideas, or how would this be like a corrupt way to practice science, or
a what way?
Corrupt way to practice science.
Corrupt
does
way.
It give us an excuse to not do things empirically?
Oh, lots of things give us excuses. Darwin's theory gives people excuses to say, well, this must have evolved somehow. So I wouldn't doubt that some people would you know, take the short routes under any particular paradigm, including intelligent design. But I think that, you know, scientists are serious people and they seriously want to know the way the world works. And so if you're postulating that the intelligent design, the idea of intelligent design did in fact spread in the scientific community over time, I think people would ask serious questions like, how deeply into nature does design extend, such as I kind of gave an overview of yesterday. Are there design systems beyond basic molecular ones, like, you know, whole organelles, or even ecosystems, or things like that? So you can ask a lot of good questions, and scientists are people too, so that they will be lazy on occasion. They'll, you know, try and take an easy way out, but people do that right now anyway, so I don't think that would make things worse.
Is it fundamentally, like the question of the origin of life in the universe, is it, would it be theological or philosophical rather than scientific?
Oh, it's both, it's all. It's philosophical and theological because basic questions about what is life and where did we come from by definition are that. And they certainly can have scientific components too, but that doesn't mean that a single question can't have implications across a boundary of disciplines, a bunch of disciplines. Okay, the question was why is it rationally justified to impose meaning on a process, evolution, which most people think is totally random? Well, for a couple of reasons. First, most people might be wrong. To believe that a process is totally random. As I'm sure you know in the history of science, people have, the whole community of scientists, the whole world has been wrong a number of times. Believing in the ether, the substance that fills space, believing in that the sun goes around the earth, and so on. So that's not a reason for believing or disbelieving anything in particular. And I do not think we are imposing meaning, I did not use the word meaning, I said purpose and design. So an outboard motor might have a purpose, I don't think it has much of a meaning. It might to some fishermen, I don't know. So I don't think we are imposing purpose on these systems. As I tried to illustrate with the jungle trap, I don't think many people would say that is random and our minds are just imposing some sort of order. I think they would perceive that it was ordered, that the best explanation for its existence is that somebody purposely put it together. So I don't think we are imposing it. And I think that most people who do think that it's random are probably have that belief simply because they kind of were taught that way and not necessarily because they've reasoned to it themselves.